in all the years we've been doing Earth Ancients, which we started in 2014, I have not talked about the Shroud of Turin. Today we are going to discuss this. We know, those of you who know about the Turin, it is thought to have been the face of Christ. It's a length of linen cloth which has the image of a man that we believe to be the Christ. But in the 1980s, I believe, scientific evidence, carbon dating, revealed that the linen was from the Middle Ages, between 1260 and 1390. But the question is, how did this image get transposed into linen? There's been a ton of scientific evidence, but there's also a lot of theory, and a number of books have come out on this problem. And today we are going to try to figure out exactly what took place. And my guests today are Lynn Picknett and Clive Prince, and they have written a book called The Turin Shroud, How Da Vinci Fooled History. This is a fascinating book, and today we are going to extract from them exactly what they discovered. Lynn and Clive, welcome to Earth Ancients.
Lovely to be on. Thank you very much, Cliff.
Yes, hello, Cliff.
Yes. What did you both decide that this is something that you wanted to research? It's not an easy topic to dissect, but what was the motivation to start research on this?
Strangely enough, it was the carbon dating. I mean, we both separately knew quite a bit about the shroud and knew that it was a very, very strange object, a very strange image, because it wasn't a painting, wasn't a brass rubbing. You know, it was just this very bizarre, mysterious image. But when the carbon dating came out in the late 1980s, mm-hmm. and, you know, conclusively said it was medieval or early Renaissance fake, we went along with that. We totally agreed that that's what it was. But that, of course, was the point when we realized it was even more remarkable as a man-made thing. It was the most incredible artifact the world has ever seen. Mm-hmm. So being quite bloody-minded, as we say over here, being very perverse, that was the moment we decided to look into it.
Okay.
Yeah. Well, everyone else went off because there was this dismissive thing at the time when the carbon dating was announced, and you know, a lot of people just said, oh, well, if it's not the genuine thing, then it's not interesting, so we'll forget about it. And that's when then I was saying, no, hang on, the mystery actually isn't how old this thing is. The mystery is how the image got there. That's the thing no one's been able to explain. And that was as incompatible with a medieval or early Renaissance date as it was with a first century date. So we thought it was unfair that everyone else was dismissing it. So everyone else went off it. That's when, as Lynn said, out just being the perverse people we are, we got interest and thought, yep, we want to find out how this was done.
And who did it?
Yeah.
And
yeah.
Who did it? Yeah.
I thought it was quite interesting that one of the noted Turin authors, Ian Wilson, was very dismissive of this carbon dating, even as it appeared to be the final word.
The irony is, Cliff, that he was one of the most vociferous proponents, you know, of the lobby that wanted the Turin Shroud to be carbon dating in the first place. He was so convinced it would prove that it was first century, you know, and therefore to him it would prove it was, you know, actually the shroud of Jesus, that in fact, you know, he and many others were lobbying, you know, and saying, come on, we release it, come on, Vatican, release it, we have to have it carbon dated. And then when it was carbon dated and it came up with a result he and they didn't like, he said, oh, well, carbon dating isn't perfect, you know, I mean, it's obviously just there's a blip in it, you know, it's just wrong, you know.
Yeah, which is and odd.
Yeah, well, it's understandable, but it's not right, you know. So that was just a really strange moment, and you know, and then there was an awful lot of bad feeling. I mean, within the true believers, because you know, obviously an awful lot of them felt they'd been kicked in their souls by the results of the carbon dating. And, you know, quite a lot of them just slunk away. But the others were sort of even more fiercely started to be defensive and to defend their corner, as it were. So it wasn't a very healthy or cuddly atmosphere that we entered at that stage.
Was the general feeling when these dates came back to medieval time, 1260 to 1390, that basically proved that this could not have been Jesus Christ or Jesus of Nazarene? Was it just depression, shock, and disbelief, or was it like, oh my God, we got to start from scratch because our theories are all wrong?
Well, as Lynn was saying, it was before the carbon dating. The likes of Ian Wilson and the other kind of real believers, the Shrouders, as they call themselves, were so convinced that if it was carbon dated, it was going to prove that it was Jesus. That they all, you read the stuff they wrote before the carbon dating, they're all saying things like, well, if it doesn't come out at 2,000 years old, then we are going to have to rethink our theories and reconsider everything. And they're all kind of quite, open, as if they were open-minded about that. But then as soon as the results came out and it wasn't what they were expecting, they suddenly said, they did start to question things. They started to question carbon dating and how accurate that was. And they started they started to come up with theories of how this, carbon dating isn't perfect. Yeah. It has made mistakes, and they started to come up with theories about how the mistakes could have happened. In this case, there was some conspiracy theories going around about actually it was all a plot by the Vatican or something to disprove the shroud for some reason or other, and they swapped it for another piece of cloth. And there were some more sort of reasonable ones about maybe there was some, mold or something on the cloth that had made it appear younger than it was. But our point when we first started to get involved in seriously looking at the shroud was that you don't need the carbon dating to know that it's a fake, because there were telltale things on the image itself, almost perfect as it is, that do give away the fact that it was a man-made artifact.
Yeah, everything comes down to how it looks. And actually, you don't need to know anything about all the theories or all the history or, whatever. You don't need to know anything, any background at all. You need to approach it with the eye of a child, basically. We had a child with us on one occasion when she saw the image. And for example, she said, why is the head too small and why is it on wrong?
Exactly.
And that was pretty amazing. that kind of thing. You look at the image and there's a whole series of things that are very strange about it. For example, the hands are crossed over the genitals, which, was obviously there because the man was being put on display. He was for display, Mm-hmm. The face is very composed indeed for somebody who was allegedly tortured to death. The whip marks on the back don't overlap as they would in real life. They're designed. It's a sort of pattern that's designed. And the hair frames the face very neatly, which it wouldn't if it was somebody who was actually lying down. It would fall back. But the one major thing, which is absolutely 100% certain, is that the image, by the way, in case people don't know, it's of the front of a man kind of hinged at the head and of his back as well.
Right.
And the man is 6'8" at the front and 6'10" at the back.
God. No, I remember reading that it was just very you couldn't find anybody to kind of reproduce it because nobody was that tall.
Yes. Yeah. The two halves don't match up and they're supposed to be, it's supposed to be Jesus was laid on this cloth, one half of it, and the top half was folded over him so that when whatever process happened that created the image, it had the front and back on the cloth. Mm-hmm. But then you look, and they're created at the same moment. So, if the front and the back don't match up, the main reason being because of the 2-inch difference in height, then, the thing can't be genuine.
Yeah. I want to get into Giovanni in a minute, but I want to start off with this detective and this exhibition that you were involved in, Lynn, where you displayed a reproduction of the shroud. Can you pick it up from there and kind of lead us along into your connection with Giovanni?
Well, yeah, it wasn't a reproduction of the shroud exactly. What it was the full-length photographic negative of the shroud. Okay. So basically, it was, you know, looking as if you're actually looking at the shroud, except it's a photographic negative.
But this, I mean, display was at
transparency. Sorry, transparency. I meant to say transparency.
Right. Yeah. But this was a public display of this image of the shroud. Yeah. How well was it received by the public when it was put up?
Well, it was kind of the centerpiece. I was guest curator for an exhibition called The Unexplained at the Royal Photographic Society in the city of Bath. And it was just after the carbon dating. And everybody was agog. Everybody was talking about it. And so we built a special light box to put the transparency on, the full-length transparency on. Mm-hmm. And people could come and, you know, look at it. And take their time and look at it. And it was an awful lot of interest. And a couple of years later, I guest curated another exhibition also called The Unexplained for the National Media Museum, where this time we had a whole room, a huge room that was empty apart from this full-length light box with the transparency again on it. But it was quite low to the ground, so you could walk in, take your time, walk around it, look down at it. So basically you were doing something that a pilgrim to the real thing could never, ever do. And you could really look, and that was when we started to get all the comments, people saying, he's very tall, isn't he? He's really tall. And say, it's very odd. His face is very odd. It's very thin at the front, but it's, you know, and his chin is low at the front, but his head is tilted at the back and things like this. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's just people who didn't know anything about it. They were just simply looking at it and coming out with this. So that was just absolutely amazing.
Okay. So tell us, pick it up where Giovanni comes in and he starts giving you hints about the possible origins of the linen, possible techniques that were used, so forth and so on. This is a very unusual fellow, isn't he?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, this was the time it came out of this exhibition in Bath. At the time, Lynn did a lot of publicity for it, particularly on radio in the UK. excuse me. And as a result of that, Lynn got some letters from this guy who signed himself Giovanni, who claimed to be part of a secret society that went back many centuries and had many, many secrets, and that it included Leonardo as one of its members. Back in the day, and it was him that really kind of gave us this kind of tip off that Leonardo da Vinci was the person responsible for the shroud. And it's one of those things that, you know, a lot of our critics have said, well, you know, you just had this strange guy who claimed to be a member of a secret society claim up and tell you this, and you've just accepted everything he said and written a book about it. But that's not what happened. He just basically gave us this tip off. We always liken it to you know, when the police are investigating a crime and they get an anonymous tip off about who's responsible for the crime. You know, that just points them in a direction that they can then investigate and either show that the person named was responsible for the crime, or find they were innocent of it. So that's all that we did. We really took this guy, which is what he wanted us to do. In fact, you know, he just gave us this idea that Leonardo was the person responsible for the shroud, and kind of like, you go off and prove it. So that set us in that direction. And it wasn't the first person. Leonardo's name has come up in connection with the shroud before. Lots of people, you know, even believers that the shroud is authentic, would often make these kind of comments that, if the shroud is a fake, the image is so remarkable that only someone with a genius like Leonardo da Vinci's could produce it. So his name was kind of in the air a lot. But then we got this more specific, say, tip-off from Giovanni. We never found out who Giovanni was.
We did meet him once.
We met him once. Lynn had a series of letters from him, and eventually we met him once in a hotel in central London. He was a perfect casting for a secret society member in a movie. He was so he was so theatrical and enigmatic and gnomic in the things that he said, which is, you know, the whole point. It was drama to draw us in.
Would you say that it was his suggestion that the church and Da Vinci were together in this farce to perhaps create a memento, a religious icon that would bring in more followers if this was the true Christ?
I think yes, because I mean, relics were big business back in those days. You know, throughout the medieval period and beyond, relics brought in pilgrims. Pilgrims brought in money, so they were the tourist attractions of their day, the Disney World of their day. So, and the better relic, the more money he made out of it. And the best relics, of course, were those of Jesus himself, who, of course, because he is supposed to have, you know, ascended to heaven, left very little behind. There's only kind of like a few artifacts connected with him. So, and the shroud would obviously be the biggest one of all, because not only is it a memento of Christ himself, of a relic of Christ himself, it commemorates, you know, two great moments in Christian thinking. You know, it's the crucifixion, the shedding of the redemptive blood, and it's created at the moment of the resurrection. So you couldn't get a better relic to pull in people than this. Now, yes, the Vatican, Catholic Church must have been involved. The other people that have been involved were the family that owned the relic, the Savoy family, you know, very wealthy and politically powerful family of the time. So they were the ones that, you know, the Savoy family were going to make the most money out of it, but then the church would make a lot out of it too. So there's obviously a collusion between them to create this wonderful relic. But then they went, well, who can create this relic that will convince people that it's genuine? Who will come up with a technique that looks like it's a miracle? So obviously they go to the man, Leonardo,
the man of miracles,
the smartest person around. Exactly. So he's involved in it. But we also think that Leonardo didn't just do it for the money. He did it for a lot of other reasons as well, partly for the joke, because something that most people don't realize, I think most people do get, but not from the history books, is that Leonardo was a great practical joker.
Leonardo was not, you know, when you're at school and you learn about Leonardo, you think, oh, he was this genius, but he was quite boring, really. But in fact, he was absolutely anything but. He was very funny. Everybody who knew him at the time and left a record of meeting him said he was hilarious. When they had entertainments at the various courts he worked at, they were great entertainments. He designed the costumes and the makeup and the special effects. He was very big on special effects. He made robots. He did all sorts of things. He was really into faking, hoaxing, practical jokes. And he was known as such for doing all that. And there was one big joke about the shroud. No doubt we'll be talking about in a moment, but you can't stress this too much, actually. We believe that Leonardo created the shroud using a very basic photographic technique, which, as I say, we'll probably talk about in more detail in a moment. But that's basically it. Now, the Catholic Church which was all powerful in those days, had reserved particular hostility towards what we might call the various stages of primitive photography. Loads of people in those days were experimenting with things like projecting images, mm-hmm. but the church came down on them like a ton of bricks. I mean, they actually faced being arrested for sorcery and even burned at the stake for doing really simple things like projecting images. So Leonardo, we believe firmly, the evidence really shows that Leonardo used a photographic technique to create the Turin Shroud, a technique that the church who had commissioned him had banned. Hmm. Now, he used this knowing full well that the people who hated it would look after it because it's the ultimate sacred relic. So they would look after his amazing piece of work that was using a banned technique, and they look after it for centuries and centuries and centuries. Mm. I mean, that's the big joke. That's the huge irony. And Leonardo was presumably hoping that one day somebody would recognize it for what it is. And here we are.
I have to ask you, though, you show that Da Vinci actually created it in 1492. Did you show or did you find records of the church actually putting it in display around the same time that it was created?
Yes, absolutely. This was one of the things that things began to fall into place for us, because we knew before this Giovanni character came along, we obviously were familiar with the accepted history of the Shroud. And of course, when he said Leonardo da Vinci was involved, there's one like really obvious problem, because although there aren't records of the Shroud that is in Turin today going back for 2,000 years, the very first document referring to what is supposed to be today's Shroud actually was written about 100 years before Leonardo da Vinci was born. So that was the obvious thing. We thought, well, it's a nice idea, but but it must be wrong because of this early document. And that shroud it was owned by a very minor French noble family, who then sold this relic to the Savoy family, who were much more much higher status family, and that is supposedly the same relic that has been around ever since. So I think, well, if that's true, then it couldn't have been Leonardo that did it. But so we looked into the story of this, and the one thing is that that early document from 100 years before Leonardo obviously it only describes the shroud, and it says it's a shroud, but it's got an image of Jesus Christ on it. But everybody that talked about that shroud at the time said it's a painting. And in fact, people even said, we know the guy that painted it. The local bishop said this. And whatever you think of today's shroud, it's certainly not a painting. But the other thing we found is that when it was sold to the Savoys, it disappears. It's supposed to be their great relic, and you don't hear anything of it for nearly 40 years. Mm. And then it's displayed again, and it's displayed in 1494. And it's displayed in a town called Vercelli, which is only a matter of a few miles from Milan, which is where Leonardo da Vinci was living and working at that time. So it was at that moment that we thought, actually, the big objection that would have stopped us even looking any further into the theory at all. Not only was these earlier references, clearly not to the same relic. It's supposed to be the same relic, but it's not. But then you've got this gap where it vanishes. Before, everyone who looks at it says, yeah, it's very nice, but it's a painting. Literally everybody. There were, church inquiries into the early relic, and they all come back and said, it's a painting. It disappears, then it comes back, and everyone's attitude to it is entirely different. They're looking at it saying, this is a miracle. The Pope endorses it for the first time. And this all happens at exactly the right time and the right place. So
yeah, we have this idea that maybe Leonardo would lurk in the shadows, gauging people's reaction to his shroud as it lay there, being displayed.
Mm-hmm. I want to get into the techniques that you discovered for the creation of the shroud. But before I do that, you mention a number of secret societies. One of them is the Priory of Sion, Priory of Sion. And what influence do you think that would be on a Leonardo da Vinci, this genius who is really a different on a different level of humanity than most of the average people? But was he involved in a secretive society like the Templars or this Sion group?
Well, it's very interesting because, you know, certainly the authors of Holy Blood, Holy Grail, you know, the landmark book in the 1980s, claimed that Leonardo had been Grand Master in his day of this society, the Priory of Sion, a French-based society that allegedly protected the bloodline of Jesus. Mm-hmm. And it was, you know, it's a very nice thought. But actually, we did an awful lot of research into the Priory of Sion, which does exist today. But basically, the whole theory falls apart because the Priory of Sion really only started in the 1950s. So you know.
Yeah.
So somehow we don't think Leonardo was a member.
But, no.
Having said, and also the Giovanni we mentioned earlier, he did present himself to us as a member of the Priory of Sion, which people know about from Holy Blood, Holy Grail, or perhaps more people these days know about it from the Da Vinci Code, because they featured there. It's another. It's a similar thing to attitudes to the shroud. It's either genuinely Jesus or it's not interesting at all. Lynn and I often find ourselves caught in this kind of middle position because certainly when the Da Vinci Code came along, everything about the Priory of Sion was polarized between people that believed it was exactly what it exists, and it's exactly as depicted in the Da Vinci Code. It's been around for centuries, and it protects the bloodline of Jesus Christ. Mm-hmm. On the other hand, the critics of that book said it's all just a hoax from the 1950s. It was just a joke that some French people did for whatever reason. Now, we researched the Priory of Sion for many, many years, and we knew that the truth is between the two, that actually the Priory of Sion as such, if you like, the brand name Priory of Sion was created in the 1950s, but it wasn't just a hoax, it was a cover. It was a cover for other secret societies that do have longer pedigrees, not thousands of years, but certainly at least 200 or 300 years, and that it was created so that these societies could do certain things in the semi-public gaze without giving away who they really were. And so we went through this whole thing with the Giovanni character, that he presented himself as a member of the Priory of Sion. At that time, we were quite open to the idea because we didn't know as much about things as we learned later. But then we went through a whole thing of saying, well, Priory of Sion doesn't exist, so who was this Giovanni character? Then you realize that, you know, he's a member of one of these other societies that are behind the Priory of Sion, act under that cover. And those societies are very much part of the European esoteric scene that does have a long tradition, that does go way back into the Renaissance and beyond. And it does pass down secrets from members. And it certainly passed things on from Leonardo's day and about Leonardo himself. So some of this information could very well have been passed down. We don't, because the Priory of Sion never existed historically, Leonardo da Vinci couldn't have been the Grand Master as they claim. They have produced this whole list of Grand Masters with some of the most famous names in European history in there. But the more you look into that list, the more you realize these aren't random names that have just been put together to make it look good, that there are specific reasons as much to do with the traditions that these individuals were part of. So, it's not a secret society in this very kind of fixed way, that a membership that went down the centuries, but there are societies that draw on traditions and secrets and information that were around before then. So the whole prior-Zion thing, it's like, well, it's not true, but it is. It bases itself on something true. So information about Leonardo could very well have come down through this path, because there is one particular path in it that does have a very strong tradition connected with Leonardo being into esoteric arts, which we discovered he was, but historically this wasn't known.
Let's talk a little bit about these esoteric arts. You have a part of the book where you describe an individual who, after Da Vinci passes, was shocked that all his book notes had been scattered and went around and basically collected his manuscript in what is now known as the Codex Atlanticus. Did you find any reference to alchemy or any type of notation that would lead you to believe that he was preparing or had actually done the actual creation of this shroud?
There's certainly no known reference to the shroud in any of his known notebooks, but there's a very interesting footnote in a book written by the last king of Italy, who was of the Savoy family, who had traditionally owned the shroud. His widow wrote a book, and she just made this bald statement in it. She said, the shroud of Turin is a fake. Well, okay, that could just be her opinion. But there's a very interesting thing, that after Leonardo died, the Savoys sent messengers basically to buy just one specific notebook. And we don't know why, but one specific notebook of his. And basically then they lost it. They put it in their archives, and according to them, oh, they can't find it. But put the two things together, and almost certainly they didn't lose it. And the certainty of the last Savoy queen, basically, saying the Shroud of Turin is a fake. I think maybe, you know, that was some evidence in there about him faking the shroud.
That's fascinating.
I mean, the other thing you ask about the alchemy and the esoteric arts, yes, that there are... Leonardo did use alchemical terminology, which shows that he's familiar with it. And there are references to the Hermetic philosophy, which wouldn't be surprising, because in Italy, and particularly in Florence, where Leonardo was, or you know, began, that was the big thing of the day, the Hermetic philosophy. I mean, everybody was into it, and there wasn't the distinction you have now between science and art and the occult. So any... you know, educated and connected Florentine of that period would have been aware of alchemy, of hermeticism, of various other sort of what we today label as occult arts, which had their very practical sides too, as in alchemy, which enabled people to come up with actual scientific techniques, such as photography.
Let's talk about this piece of work. Da Vinci really shows off his great genius in the creation of what can only be considered a form of photography hundreds of years before the camera, the emulsions are created, and photography is used by the general public. Can you talk a little bit about how he went about doing this? He must have created the earliest form of emulsions use in capturing an image. Can you go through the process as you understand it?
Well, before Clive, who actually reproduced it, will talk about in detail, just to say that Leonardo actually is known from his notebooks to have built his own camera, a camera obscura, meaning basically a dark room. And you know, in his notebooks, there's a drawing of it, a diagram of it. And he was totally obsessed with optics and light. That was his big obsession, was trying to capture most lifelike images using light, essentially. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to hand over to Clive, because he's the genius who was the first person ever to reproduce all the so-called miraculous characteristics of the Turin Shroud.
Yeah, I also will mention my brother at this point, my brother Keith, who was part of these experiments we did way back now in the early 1990s, because the only way to prove the idea that the Shroud image is a photograph is to prove that it was possible using the materials and techniques that were available in Leonardo's day to make a photographic image. And, you know, again, the starting point of a lot of this was the big mystery about the image on the Turin Shroud is that it behaves like a photograph. It looks more lifelike when you see it in photographic negative. And this was one of the things that said, well, nobody could produce a negative image, way back medieval, early Renaissance, even more recently than that. So therefore, there's something mysterious about that. But then you think, well, the actual idea is it behaves like a photograph because it is. It makes a lot of sense. But it makes sense. But in the end, the only way you can do it is to prove that it was possible if you were a bit of a genius. So it was my brother and I, we spent many months kind of locked away in my garage trying to sort of figure out this technique, using materials that were around, projecting the image, the actual kind of camera part of it was not a problem. That had been known for millennia before Leonardo.
Yeah, and they had scopes. They had cut lenses that were using for telescopes for observation at that time. So that's a natural. I think the bigger issue is the chemical composition, which is the emulsion, which is the genius. So go ahead.
Yeah, it's the equivalent of the emulsion. And we found... we realized we had to come up with just one way of doing it. We probably thought there were actually kind of many ways of actually producing this, and we've found since that it's true, because other people have come up with other techniques using other materials that also produce photographic images. So we're not saying sort of our way is definitely the way Leonardo did it. It's just one way he could have done it. And there are actually quite a lot of naturally occurring substances that are light sensitive. In other words, they change either color or some other characteristic when they're exposed to light. For example, the first known photograph that history acknowledges back in the 19th century, the equivalent of the emulsion on that was simply a type of naturally occurring bitumen. So there were all these different chemicals, and particularly ones that were used in the tanning industry, that were known to be sensitive to light, to change color or something. And people had been experimenting with some ways of trying to get an image to actually be fixed and to stay there once they projected it using a camera obscura. Very briefly, all the details are in the book, but the technique we hit upon in the end was one that it uses a quality of certain chemicals and various ones that when they're exposed to light, they don't necessarily change color. They do a bit, but that's not really the point. Is that they become waterproof. There's a chemical reaction that makes them waterproof. So what happens is you can expose something to light. The areas where the light has fallen become hard and waterproof. The bits where the shadows were stay soluble in water. So you can wash the cloth out and you're left with the light parts, although in negative, they remain. But even that doesn't quite can totally fix the image. What you do then is if you heat the cloth, it acts a bit like invisible ink, that it actually scorches where this the chemical mixture has hardened. It scorches the image onto the cloth. And then once you've done that, you can actually wash the cloth in hot water and detergent and other things, completely remove the chemical. And what you're left with is an image on the cloth, a negative image that's literally been scorched into the top fibers of the cloth. And it's always, people that have analyzed the Shroud image have always said, one of the inexplicable things about it is it's just like a scorch mark. It's like it's been burnt into the cloth. So you've got all these different characteristics that people said, you know, no technique could reproduce, that our image does. You know, it, all of it, exactly. The ones, as they said, it couldn't be done.
Would so, you yeah, say, we, would you, let me just stop you for a minute, Clive. Would you say that the image we see today is 100% photographic and there is very little, if any, painting at all? Because there's some that believe it was a painted image.
Well, there's virtually no paint on it. There's tiny little bits which might have come off paintings of icons that they used to, pilgrims used to lay on it. Tiny, you know, almost not there, bits of paint. But the actual image is certainly not painted. We do believe that the hair, Leonardo actually painted the hair on, but using the same chemicals as he used for the rest of the image.
Oh, and, fascinating.
And the blood stains are painted on.
Yeah.
The blood from the crucifixion wounds and so on, that was painted, they effectively painted, probably using real blood or blood mixed with something else. You know.
And the reason, I have to say, the reason that he would have to paint the hair on, and the hair is very weird, actually, when you look at it, framing the face, because we discovered when we did, we used a plaster head for our experiments, and we discovered that actually using a camera obscura with a lens like as we did, that in fact the image that comes out, there are no ears. The ears disappear. It's like a fisheye effect. So you have to paint the hair on. So that was one thing. But the other really big thing, I just have to say, was that very briefly, we believe that Leonardo did it, the images in basically... Well, certainly the head is separate from the body. The face at the front, he did separately from the front of the body and all of the back of the body. And what we discovered just by observation and actually almost by accident was in the dead center of the face on the bridge of the nose, there is the image of the lens.
Oh, my God. How did you find that out? You must have really... zeroed in using some kind of a optical observation tool of some kind.
No.
What happened was that when my brother and I were doing these experiments, we kept getting this effect. It's got what photographers call burnout. So you actually kind of get a little image of the lens because you're using a very simple lens, not like the complex ones in today's cameras. And we kept getting this on the images we were creating, and we were frustrated by it. Mm. We think, like, how do we get rid of this? Mm. Because it was always there. I mean, sometimes stronger than others, but it was always there. And we're thinking, well, and in the end, we just thought, I wonder if Leonardo had the same problem. So we just got a picture of the face of the man on the shroud, and just, I mean, anyone can do this now. You look at it, and there's a light circle on the middle of the face, which kind of nobody really noticed because nobody had been looking for it.
No.
But it's there. It's a perfect circle with it's a light circle with a slightly darker ring around it. And that's when we looked at it and we thought, that's the lens. That's Leonardo's lens.
Yeah.
This is.
Wow. Yeah.
So we came up with the idea that, yes, the Turin Shroud is a 500-year-old photograph. And it's a 500-year-old photograph made by Leonardo da Vinci.
But there's an even bigger thing, that it's a 500-year-old photograph partly of Leonardo da Vinci.
Oh, that's because, what I want to talk about. So the actual shroud is in two parts. It's actually a self-portrait of da Vinci himself with some modifications. Lynn, you said that he added some hair, possibly did some using this emulsion, highlighted it, but the body. Now, this is what I didn't understand in the book: is the body from an actual crucified individual, or is it is it an individual who has been modified with some da Vinci highlights?
It's almost certainly a truly crucified person. But the thing to remember is that Leonardo was an anatomist. He had special dispensation to dissect corpses. He had access to as many corpses as he wanted. So, you know, that's your explanation for that, really.
Okay. So if this person, is it a mistake that he was 6'8"? Or is it it's an optical illusion?
No, it's a projected image, so it can be any height. The fact that it's, 2 inches different. I mean, we believe that, we know that Leonardo was a great hoaxer, but also a master psychologist. And he knew that people wouldn't necessarily see anything different. They wouldn't see what they weren't looking for. They would see what they expected to see. But they would be unsettled by strange clues that they wouldn't get consciously at all. They're just subliminal clues. They would get unsettled by weirdnesses that he added to an awful lot of his work. And, when you've got somebody who is incredibly tall, who is supposed to be Jesus, that would work on your subconscious, for generations, really, for centuries.
And it also, this being a composite image and projected, it also explains, the thing we had from the little girl that Lynn was talking about in the museum, in the exhibition in Bath, when she just looked at it and said, the head's too small and it's on wrong.
Yeah.
And actually it is, the whole kind of data of that is in the book. But yes, the head, it was produced separately and it's too small for the body when you actually kind of work out the normal ratios. Again, you don't really look at that, as Im was saying, it's psychology. Most people look at it and don't notice. But when, how old was she? 9 or something?
Yeah,
a 9-year-old points it out and you kind of think, actually, she's onto something.
Yeah.
But now it's a composite image and they're projected. So, they can put in much any size.
I have to say this, though, and you do highlight it a little bit. This is the medieval period, so they did do a lot of barbaric things to people in the Inquisition and so forth and so on. But this individual was actually crucified. Did they actually have records of people being crucified during the period of 1492 or whatever?
Well, you wouldn't need to. I mean, basically, the New Testament tells you all you need to know about how to do it. And Leonardo, with his complete access to unlimited corpses, would behind closed doors have just experimented with crucifixion techniques until he got it right. Basically,
yeah. Because of course the thing most everyone knows about Leonardo was this great perfectionist, so that when he's commissioned to do a painting, he will research the anatomy until it's absolutely right. So if it had been commissioned to paint a crucifixion, he would have gone into the anatomy and actually how crucifixion worked. And that was another thing that made people think that the shroud could be genuine, because it actually has details of the anatomy of crucifixion is absolutely right. And the detail most people pick up on as an example of that is the fact that the nail wounds on the man on the shroud are actually through the wrists, not through the palms, as they are in nearly every religious painting. And that's actually the correct way to crucify someone, because the palms can't bear the weight of a body. And people would say, in the medieval period, people didn't know that. So if they'd have faked the shroud, they'd have put the nail wounds through the palms. This wasn't. But then if you're talking about Leonardo, and there are some clues in his notebook that he did study the anatomy of crucifixion, although he never painted one. It does all come together. This sort of amazing joke, perhaps a sick one, at least a very dark joke, that Leonardo had the opportunity to produce.
But the thing that is fascinating to me, and I have to just say this, I am not a religious person whatsoever, that the church sanctioned this is amazing, because they're basically wanting people to believe that there was a Christ. Now, today, there's a lot of talk, a lot of research, and even books have been written that the Christ was made up, that he wasn't an actual person, that it was a form of getting people to believe in something that is the foundation for the church, for the dogma of religion. But if the Catholic Church, as you say, joined together, got this genius known as Leonardo da Vinci to create this shroud, it's a form of devotion that is sent out there that people believe in. So it's What can you say about that?
Well, I mean, as people might know, I'm not a great fan of the Catholic Church. I mean, it's a most cynical organization. It's all about power and control and money. It always has been, especially, you know, during the time of the popes, in the Renaissance time, Leonardo's day. And it would have been nothing to them, really, to employ an artist, albeit a genius, to produce their great ultimate relic. You know, they thought in those terms. But of course, Leonardo kind of got his own back. In fact, he did get his own back, because as I said earlier, you know, he got them to look after his great joke, forbidden technique, so that it came down untouched through the centuries to us. Mm.
And also, there's another wonderful joke in there, which is something I don't think I actually put in the book, which Leonardo, in his own writings, I mean, he was not a Christian. A point we always make is that whoever created the Turin Shroud, which is supposedly has the redemptive blood of Jesus Christ on there, whoever was doing that and trying to pass it off as the real thing could not have been a Christian. They had to have been at least a non-believer and probably a heretic. But so Leonardo was, we know from his writings, was no fan of the church. But he was also particularly no fan of holy relics. Mm. But the thing he writes in his notebooks is basically holy relics are fakes. And he actually writes in one of his notebooks that when people pray and cross themselves before a holy relic, they should really be praying and crossing themselves to the artist that created it.
That's wonderful.
It's had 500 years worth of pilgrims in that church.
Little do all those millions of pilgrims realize that who they are revering is in fact, you know, a homosexual heretic from, 500 years ago.
Yeah, we don't have time to get into his sexuality, although that's a very interesting part of your book. I do want to say this as we close, that in 1994, when the book came out, a South African professor, Nicholas Allen, declared the Shroud to be a photograph. Now, he and you got together and talked a little bit. What was his basis for his conclusion? Was it the same that you came up with, or did he have a different path?
He came up with a different technique. He used a camera obscura. He used different chemicals. Again, stuff that was widely, would have been available at the time. He doesn't believe it's Leonardo. But he certainly. And it's one of those kind of. It was the very day that our book came out. There was a UK newspaper carried a piece about this guy in South Africa that we'd never heard of, who was saying, as far as the photograph thing goes, exactly the same thing. I mean, his technique was in many ways better, because he used a crystal lens, whereas we used a glass one, and Leonardo would have had a crystal, the crystal lenses were better in those days. If we're sort of getting towards the end, there's one just thing I must throw in that since that first edition of the book came out in 1994, our critics, but even, people that kind of agreed with what we were saying would say, well, you've presented a good circumstantial case for Leonardo being involved with the Shroud or faking the Shroud, but you haven't got the smoking gun. You haven't got the proof that, that he actually did it. But since then, and in the latest edition, we have got that. And very quickly, it was when in 2011, they sort of discovered a new Leonardo painting. It's a painting called The Salvator Mundi, The Savior of the World, which is a painting of Christ, looking straight out of the picture in the same way that the man on the shroud does. And we just thought, well, that's the only one he's did of Christ looking kind of in a similar position to the guy on the shroud. Doesn't look that much like him, and what we did a comparison between the two, simply of just taking the two images, overlaying one on the other, and just making the top one more transparent to see how well the image underneath matched up. And Salvatore Mundi and the face of the man in the shroud match absolutely perfectly in a way that's kind of a coincidence. And people can actually see it, although the pictures of it in the book, it actually looks better in video. And if people go to our website, which is www.picknettprints.com, it's P-I-C-K-N-E-T-T.com, and go to the book page, they can actually see a little video on there. To go to the page for our Turin Shroud book, they can actually run a little video, and they can see how these how closely those two images match up.
That's a fascinating look. As we close here, I would like to get a final thought from both of you on your feeling about the shroud today. Is it done? Is the final word in? Or is there more speculation, more intrigue, more mystery that is left to be discovered?
Well, you know, we would love to come across his confession, obviously Leonardo's confession. We'd love that missing Savoy notebook of Leonardo's to be found and have a look at that if possible. But basically, as far as we're concerned, you know, Leonardo did it. We're 100% certain about that. It would be wonderful if the Turin Shroud could be removed from the church, physically from the church and figuratively from the Catholic Church, and given its own museum. I mean, basically that's what it deserves. It's, you know, it's an artifact. It's not a painting. It's a photograph. It's the world's first photograph by and of Leonardo da Vinci.
Wow, fantastic. The book is The Turin Shroud. My guests today have been Lynn Picknett and Clive Prince. How Da Vinci Fooled History. What a wonderful book. I strongly urge you to go out and get a copy. And I want to thank you both for joining me. And we're going to have you back because I have discovered that you are both prolific authors. And there's a new book that has just come out. We'll talk about it real, real soon. So, hey, thank you for joining me.
Well, thanks very much, Cliff. It's been brilliant.
Thanks for inviting us. It's been fun.
Yeah.
Been great fun.
Yeah.
Thank you.